We heard President Obama address the situation in the press conference at the White House, and he's joining us this morning to discuss his thoughts. Please welcome the President of the United States, President Barack Obama.
Steve, great to be with you as always, man.
Always good, sir. Happy to have you on this. I know this is not the most pleasant occasion, but I know you've been watching this from the White House. What are your thoughts on what we're seeing happening in Baltimore?
Well, and unfortunately, we've seen these police-related killings or deaths too often now. And obviously, everybody is starting to recognize that this is not just an isolated incident in Ferguson or in New York, but we've got some broader issues. Now, as I said yesterday, the kind of violence, looting, destruction that we saw from a handful of individuals in Baltimore, there's no excuse for that. That's not a statement. That's not politics. That's not activism. That's just criminal behavior. And it's counterproductive because it hurts the very communities that are already suffering a tragedy with Freddie Gray's death.
Absolutely.
And disrespects the family. So, my hope is that people heed the call of Mr. Gray's family and saying, this is not what we want to see. It also distracts from the very positive protests and organizing that had been carried out by faith groups and community leaders in a number of venues and over successive days. That wasn't what ended up being focused on. Instead, what you got is a focus on a CVS burning. And so people who engage in that kind of violence, there's no excuse for it, and that needs to stop.
Yeah.
Having said that, what is also true is that we have to address these problems in a serious way. It's happening too often. And, my heart goes out to the police officers who were injured over the last few days. They showed appropriate restraint, and a number of them were hurt with stuff being thrown at them and in the midst of these disturbances. And it shows you how tough a job policing can be. But what we also know is that, like any other profession, there are times where folks aren't doing what they should be doing. And that's true of politicians. It's true of police officers. And rather than close ranks, we have to have accountability and transparency. I've sent in the Justice Department and investigate what happened. We've sent in our community policing office to work with the city of Baltimore and the community to try to find some longer-term solutions to how to address these issues. But as I said yesterday, this is not just a job for the Justice Department. It's not even just the job for police departments. It's a job for all of us as a society to start tackling what have been chronic problems, not just these last couple of years, but these are problems that have been going on for a very long time.
Are there any plans at all to travel to Baltimore at any point? Do you think that would have any value to it?
Well, when I travel, I take a lot of assets out of where they need to be, which is why usually when there's disturbances or natural disasters, I usually try to let law enforcement or emergency responders do their work once things have cleared up. I think there's going to be a time where I go back to Baltimore, a city obviously that's close by and I'm familiar with. And, you've got a mayor there who cares about the community. I spoke to her a couple of days ago, and she obviously is heartbroken by what happened, particularly because she herself has championed, addressing problems within police departments and how they approach, the black community. But But I think the most important thing we can do is build on the task force report that was issued in the wake of Ferguson, where I brought together law enforcement and community activists, including some of the young activists who had helped to organize protests in Ferguson. And they came up with a really solid document that gave specific recommendations to cities and counties and states in terms of how you could improve the situation, retraining police officers, making sure that technology like body cameras are deployed intelligently, keeping data. You know, in a lot of these places, people don't even know how often there's a shooting incident with police or a problem that results in the death of somebody in police custody. And so just keeping the data could help us identify ways to improve the situation. And so they had a series of recommendations, and now our job is to work with local police departments, states, counties, mayor's offices, governor's offices, to implement it. Because, you know, law enforcement is typically at the local level. And I can't deputize every police department in the country. What I can do, though, is to provide them, here's the best practices, you know, to get in front of this problem. And what we're also trying to do through the Justice Department is to provide them some incentives to change how they do things. So they need additional training money to implement some of these programs. You know, they need grants to purchase body cameras that allow them to keep track of what's going on. You know, they may need additional technology to improve data collection so that they can you know, stay transparent with the community about what's happening and improve reporting when there are police incidents that you know, raise questions. All that stuff we can help, but ultimately at the community level, people have to insist on a different way of doing business. And part of what I've said is that police departments themselves need to understand that if they want to be successful and create a safer environment for their officers, then they've got to build more trust. They and it's in their interest to root out folks who aren't doing the right thing, to hold accountable people when they do something wrong, instead of just the closing ranks approach that all too often we see that ends up just feeding greater frustration and ultimately, I think, can put more police officers in danger.
Are there ways out there, Mr. President, in which you feel as though the communities can be involved in working with the task force that you implemented, the 21st Century Task Force? You know, because people are looking for ways which they can engage on this issue, you know, some point of action.
Well, absolutely. I mean, I think the first thing to do is to know that, you know, we are ready and willing to make Department of Justice resources and the task force resources available to any community that is prepared to tackle this problem in a serious way. And in fact, you know, our new Attorney General, Loretta Lynch, she's already reached out to mayors across the country to let them know of the resources that are available. And so really the key here is for communities to make sure that their law enforcement agencies, whether it's police, sheriff's offices, or what have you, are engaged with the community, that they're reaching out to our community policing office, our COPS program. We'll walk them through the resources that are available. We'll walk them through the recommendations that have been made. We'll walk them through best practices. We'll put them in touch with law enforcement offices that have improved their practices and rebuilt trust in the wake of some of these problems. So there are a lot of resources available, but local communities have to want it. You know, I think that it's something very specific that community leadership, as they're trying to figure out what to do, can focus on is, you know, have in fact their law enforcement offices taken advantage of the resources that are out there to try to make positive change.
Yeah. Well, you know, you said something earlier, Mr. President, that the actions that a few of the young people have decided to take in terms of vandalizing and looting and destroying property, as it's not only just a disrespect to the family, but you know what? It just takes the focus off the issue at hand. You cannot allow the focus to become looting, violence, and destruction when the focus is how do we draw attention to the policies. Look, we all understand your anger. We all understand it, but we've got to develop a better way to handle this, because now the focus is on the innocent policemen that get injured. The focus is on a burning of property, neighborhoods being destroyed, looting and violence. Nobody talks about Freddie anymore.
Well, you're exactly right. And by the way, and this has been true since the 60s, these are our communities that get torn up, right? So whoever was working at that CVS, you know, they right now are wondering, are they going to get a paycheck?
Right.
And, you know, that family that need their prescription filled, now they're thinking, okay, how far do I have to drive and how much gas money do I have to spend
right
to fill prescription for grandma because I now don't have a pharmacy in my neighborhood.
Yeah.
So, you know, this kind of stuff's always self-defeating. Now, the one thing I'll say, and I said this at my press conference, is we have to widen the lens to make sure we're not just focused on the police department.
Hey, folks, we're going to come right back with more of the President of the United States. All right, everybody, we're back with more with the interview with the President of the United States.
Yeah, the police have a tough job.
Yeah.
Part of the reason the police have a tough job is because we put them into communities and situations where because of neglect, in some cases because of a history of racism or discrimination, you've got people who don't have opportunity. You've got mm-hmm. kids who can't read.
Mm-hmm.
You've got young people who think it's much more likely they're going to prison or getting killed than going to college. You've got places where fathers aren't looking after their kids, in part because they don't know how they can get a job. You've got communities that have been decimated because the male population, half of them or more, have prison records and can't get a regular job because when they apply, the employer says, no, thank you. And you've got communities that have been disinvested for years. As manufacturing has left and there's been no effort to reinvest and rebuild in these communities. And, you know, if you send police officers into those situations where, you know, the drug trade is the primary economy, and you say to them, your job is basically to contain that and to arrest kids and put them in jail, when those police officers themselves know that that's not really going to make much of a difference because those kids are going to end up right back on the streets or replaced by a new crop of kids, then it's not surprising that you end up with a situation of enormous tension between those communities and those police officers. So, you know, we can't just kind of, on the one hand, say the problems of the police, or on the other hand, say the problem are these kids engaging in violence, without also taking into account some of our responsibility as a larger society for trying to take seriously the need to rebuild many of these communities. And
wow.
A lot of the policies I've talked about in terms of early childhood education or job training or, you know, attracting businesses to these areas or building infrastructure so people have access to where the jobs are, you know, those are all things that could make a difference, but we've got to build a political movement around that as well. And I think that if all we're doing is focusing on retraining police but not dealing with some of these underlying issues, then these problems are going to crop up again. And you know, that's why, for example, Eric Holder and I had initiated conversations with members of Congress about how do we think about criminal justice reform and how we sentence these nonviolent drug offenders, and can we create more diversion programs so young people, instead of going to jail and learning how to become better criminals, are given opportunities to start thinking about how they can learn a trade and learn a skill. And that is part of the conversation that has to be had. But that's a long-term conversation that's hard to focus on. You know, people have a tendency, once the fire's been put out and the cars aren't being tipped over, and you know, there's not some immediate crisis, then folks want to go back and focus on, you know, whatever reality TV thing is going on.
And
this requires some sustained focus. We're not going to change this overnight, but we can make progress. But it requires all of us taking responsibility, not just some.
Well, you know, Mr. President, I think, first of all, thank you for taking out time of your day to even address this, especially yesterday and now again today, because you know it's an issue that's important in our community. So once again, we thank you very much. You've always fought a good fight in these communities. You're doing it again. You know, it's a lot of work to be done. I'm glad you said what you said on this topic. It's important that they hear from you on this. And it's a lot of work that's got to be done on the local level. But it's good to know that the head man up top has his eye on the situation, and is very much aware of it.
That's obviously important to me. You know, the communities in Baltimore that are having these problems now are no different than the communities in Chicago where I, you know, first started working when I moved there as a community organizer. So I've seen this movie too many times before. You know, we can make real progress, but we're going to have to do it together. And I can't do it alone. The best intentioned mayor or governor or police commissioner can't do it alone. We've all got to work together. That includes parents, includes young people, as well as police and clergy and community leaders and teachers and business leaders. But we've just got to make sure that we don't, you know, brush this aside after the crisis has passed. And that's always hard to do, but it's necessary. And I appreciate you taking the time out to give me a chance to talk to your folks out there.
Well, anytime. Mr. President, again, thank you very much, sir.
All right.
Tell the family I said hello.
You too, man. God bless.
All right, brother.
Bye-bye.
Yes, sir.